This is a Radian RMS-200, an 8GB DRAM-based SSD. I got this drive on eBay for about $60, and I was curious how these DRAM-based SSDs compare to the more traditional NAND flash-based drives. The advantages of DRAM-based SSDs is they have nearly unlimited endurance and very fast speeds, and don't have some of the overhead problems that NAND flash has, like erase blocks. The disadvantages are the high price, the small capacity, and the fact that you need capacitors to be able to store the data in case of a sudden power loss. This drive uses the NVMe protocol, so it's plug and play in almost all new systems and OSs. It'll just show up as an NVMe drive with an 8GB capacity, and you can format it and use it like any other drive could be used. Before I take a look at performance of this drive and some use cases, I want to take a look at the hardware of this drive. Because this drive is hiding a lot of its internals with this black plastic, so I'm going to pull off this cover to find out what's going on inside of this. And here's the SSD with its casing removed. The first thing I notice is this bank of supercapacitors here. And this is to store enough energy so that if power is lost suddenly, it has enough energy to copy the data from the DRAM chips over to NAND flash so that the data can be successfully restored when the system turns back on. But interestingly enough, this bank of capacitors is not connected to anything else thermally. There's plastic screws holding it in, and there's plastic covering all the things when its normal casing is on. But there's a Peltier unit connecting it to the big heatsink on the top of this, and it works like a mini heat pump, making one side cold and one side hot. I had never seen this type of cooling before in an SSD or other PCIe card, so I ran a little bit of tests using a multimeter to determine when this card turns on. And it looks like when the ambient temperature is roughly about 40 Celsius, it turns it on. And I'm guessing they did this because they wanted to keep these capacitors cooler, because capacitors often have a significant reduction in lifetime when you get them hotter, and they wanted to brand this as a long-lasting DuraLife capacitor system. Also, this SSD is designed to be used in servers where its airflow has likely already been heated by the drives and the CPU, so it's rated for up to 55 degrees C intake temperatures. So it might have been the only way they could have gotten the temperatures they needed on these capacitors. They seem to have put a lot of work into the thermal solution, because there's four little thermal probes in various places on this card too. Looking at the chips on the board, the controller is by PMC, and it's a DRAM SSD controller, built for this exact use case. Then there is 9 DRAM chips on either side. Likely it's a 72-bit bus, of which 8 bits are being used for error correction, and the other 64 bits are being used for data. There's one other chip that looks a little different than the rest of the DRAM chips, and it's a DRAM register chip. This is likely using registered ECC memory, likely for it to be able to store much more memory than you could with unregistered memory. This is similar to a registered stick that's used in some server RAM. Near the capacitors on this board, there's 2 Toshiba NAND chips that work as non-volatile storage so that this system can store data without power for about as long as you could want, as it'll stay stable on these NAND flash chips. And then there's quite a bit of different power delivery chips on this board, likely because it has to do a lot of charging, discharging, and converting power around for the different components on this system. So how does this drive perform? In a nutshell, it's extremely fast. Thanks to using DRAM instead of NAND flash, this drive is one of the fastest SSDs on the market. And here's a Crystal Disk Mark screenshot. And you might notice that the sequential speeds aren't really that great. 5.5 GB per second read and 5 GB per second write according to the manufacturer. While that's far from bad, lots of new Gen 4 NVMe drives or even Gen 5 drives are much faster than this. And why I say this is one of the fastest SSDs is due to its low latency performance, where this drive smokes almost anything else on the market. Take a look at those bottom two numbers in Crystal Disk Mark. The low latency dependent QDepth 1 performance. And this drive is really fast here. So I wanted to put together a few of the other drives I had as kind of a comparison in terms of performance. So I have a PM981, a Gen 3 X4 NVMe SSD. I have an Intel S3700 to represent a SATA SSD. I have a Samsung PM1725B to represent a enterprise class Gen 3 X8 SSD. And I have an Intel Optane 900P to represent a Optane drive, which is kind of a middle ground between NAND flash and DRAM, and has a lot of benefits of both, but still has many compromises being kind of a middle ground technology. And taking a look at the performance of these drives, the NAND flash based drive is the best in a lot of workloads, and it really shines in my read-write mixed workload. We're at a QDepth of about 4 to 8, and this drive just smoked everything else, likely because it's really good at handling a mix of different types of requests at the same time. And it also did extremely well in all the other QDepth 1 workloads, for being able to be a low latency drive, and this drive also has a huge benefit compared to a lot of other consumer grade drives that might show bigger numbers, which is it's a very sustained performance capable drive. It can write at those 5 gigabytes per second as long as you want. The DRAM doesn't wear out due to write endurance like NAND flash or even Optane does, and you can just keep going writing as much data as you want to that drive and it'll do it forever. And while it's great to have a super fast drive, 8 gigabytes of storage is pretty limiting. There's not that much you can do with 8 gigabytes of data these days. But one of the best use cases for a drive like this is a log drive. One example of a log drive being used very well is ZFS. ZFS is able to have a log drive that stores a list of all the operations it's going to have for synchronous writes onto a drive like this. And that way, if power's lost, it can go back in time, take a look at all those operations, and complete them. This then gives ZFS time to be able to complete those operations slowly and actually write those out to disk, which is especially important if you're dealing with parity RAID, which can be very slow to write to at times, which allows to have still very good performance and still have very good data security. And a drive like this is one of the best possible options for an S-log drive. So I did a little bit of performance testing using this as a ZFS S-log drive. And comparison to having no S-log drive is a massive write performance comparison. It's night and day having no S-log drive versus having an S-log drive. And even comparing it to a other NVMe class drive, even like this one here which has power loss protection, going to a RAM-based drive is still a significant improvement. And since having a large drive is not important for a ZFS log drive because it's perhaps a maximum of 5 seconds before the data gets overwritten again with the new log, a small drive like this works perfectly fine for a ZFS log drive and is likely one of the best options you can get. I wanted to try some other slightly less common options for this drive just to see what I could do. I tried using this as a boot drive of Debian. You can fit Debian on an 8GB drive, and since it is an NVMe drive, it boots in almost any new system. And it's a pretty snappy OS, except you have no space to store anything you else could want on it. You can barely even update the system, so not very good for that use case. How about a cache drive? I tried using it in Primo Cache in Windows as a cache drive for a system to try to speed up a mechanical hard drive. And while having a cache drive is super helpful, the fact that it's only 8GB limits a lot of the amount of data that you can store. And a lot of use cases, having a larger, slower cache drive is going to be better than having a super fast, super small drive. So does it make sense to buy a drive like this for your use case? I want to add another option to these graphs to show performance. And this is a RAM disk. And I used RAMFS in this system to show how fast system memory is compared to this drive. Using system memory reduces the overhead of the PCIe bus and the own controller in this system and shows much better performance results. It just smokes this drive and everything else that I had in the testing. But system memory isn't safe because if you lose power, you lose system memory. And actually, there is a solution to that using NVDIMMs. The problem is support is relatively limited hardware-wise using NVDIMMs, but if you want the best possible performance for non-volatile storage, NVDIMMs is the way to go. But if you still want to have very good performance when it comes to non-volatile storage, but you don't need a ton of space, this drive is a pretty good middle ground. And seeing that disk drive is $60 puts it in a lot of home lab and home server markets, which makes it make sense for something like a ZFS log drive or maybe a database log drive, where you still want a lot of performance, but you want it at a budget, or perhaps even just playing with software and wanting to play around with a drive like this. I think it's at a low enough price that a drive like this can make sense. It's still pretty decent performance and smokes almost any other SSD out there on the market. And for something like a ZFS S-log drive, it realistically is the best option you can get for most use cases, unless you want to spend a lot of money and get NVDIMMs. Let me know if you have thoughts on a DRAM-based SSD like this in the comments below, and if you've used something like ZFS that has a log drive and what you're using as a log drive currently.